1973 image of the Earth from space was actually a satellite image, one of the first satellite images ever taken, right? And it came to be the symbol for the environmentalist movement of, you know, the vulnerable floating ball in the middle of space that mostly is ocean, that, you know, you could disregard political boundaries, that you have to think of the Earth as one big planet, right? And it set into place a whole lot of other things, which I'll mention as well as the images come across the screen. But I wanted to point out that a lot of the imagery that follow the 1973 image are all satellite views. They're not taken as a photograph with a man standing in space, you know, looking at the Earth from very far away, but from satellites, and are composited into this globe that then harkens back to the 1973 one. So this is the new generation blue marble, which is made out of four images spliced together, then the clouds removed, then the clouds re-added. This is the 2005 new generation blue marble, which when you zoom in on it, it's one pixel, one mile per pixel. And this is the 2012 blue marble, which is 500 meters per pixel, right? So this is very high resolution now. And, you know, on your iPhone, which actually I still have the blue marble on my iPhone, it's the 2002 blue marble. And recently in my Twitter stream appeared this guy named Robert Simmons, who had picked up a copy of my book and said to me, you might want to see my blog entry. And unfortunately, it did not come in time. It was published, he published this in respect to when Steve Jobs died, because he was so proud of the fact that his image of the blue marble was on the iPhone, and he's the person, him and Rito Stockley from Oslo, actually put this image together. So what it is these four image, right? It's you know, how many? 10,000 satellite scenes with each file over 300 megabytes collected over 100 days. Then you strip out the clouds, right? And they created this huge pixel map of the Earth. And as he says, this was the hard part, but then I wanted to do something atmospheric with it. And to do that, they created another image of just the clouds, right? Because the image is useless to an image analyst with the clouds. You need to be able to see the landscape below. And they composited this image together, and in their own words, to look like the 1973 image. So this has become, you know, a very over-publicized and very popular image, but you really have to look carefully at how the image is composed, because we've really gone from that single point of view to a composited, very different kind of architecture of the image that we need to interrogate and think about as, you know, spatial analysts. What exactly is it that we're looking at? It composites about five different dimensions of space and time together in a brand new way. Okay. So, you know, I mean, and that's the final image that was on the iPhone. So as we know, as soon as the iPhone appeared, Google Earth 5.0 appeared very, very soon afterwards, right? I think this was like 2005 was the beginning of Google Earth on a computer monitor, and then when were iPhones, like 2008 or something like that, and Google Earth was on there. And the whole architecture of that, going from seeing and flying, zooming in from out of space, to saving and sharing. And you all know now that a lot of images on your iPhone actually direct you to places in the city, which is something that I'd been talking about in a lot of my projects before, but it became really visceral when smartphones appeared on the scene. So the book sort of catalogs the history of the use of satellite imagery. So Landsat was launched in 1973, just at the same time as the picture was taken from the moon by the astronauts. But these were much lower resolution. So these were like 60 kilometers per pixel, 125 kilometers per pixel. Then now the Landsat program has been continued and is actually 20 meters per pixel. At the same time, and these images are free if you live in the United States, and there's many ways that you can actually still download them for free. These images are of the secret prison in right outside of where is it? The secret prison, which was in Afghanistan, and this slide is not upside down. And this is some satellite imagery, which is used by the Harvard Sentinel project, using the satellite imagery to monitor destruction and human rights violations all around the world. But mostly they've been working in Africa, and what these are 1 meter resolution satellite images that you can actually purchase. And what you have to do is you have to task a satellite to take a picture somewhere on Earth. It's not like Landsat, which is just going around and around the Earth all the time. So the technology has been declassified and was declassified by the US government in 1995. And along with that, private companies could launch satellites, and any citizen, anywhere, any resident, any person, anywhere around the world with a credit card can purchase a satellite image and ask a satellite to go and take a photograph of something somewhere. Right? But what was not known at the time is that this is 1968, right? So even before the astronauts were taking pictures of the Earth from space, satellites had been launched actually. They were piggybacking on other space planning missions like the Voyager, and were taking these photographs, which are really spy satellite photographs, and they were really called that. So they were taken in long strips of film by the Corona program, and so they were top secret, and they were declassified. They were declassified in 1995, and this is the kind of thing that, you know, this is an image of Africa. Which was actually printed 60 by 80 feet. I really want to reconstruct this image. I'm actually looking for the pieces right now, because this would be the highest resolution photographic satellite view of Africa, which was actually, 6 meters resolution in 1968. That's the Washington Monument. So when you purchase an image now, that little thing of, it has top secret scratched out. In the way that the satellite, it was actually also sent on missions, just like the high-resolution satellites now, and they would then deorbit the capsule from the satellite on a parachute, and then an airplane would come and pick up the roll of film, and if it dropped into the ocean, there was a little beacon that would then publish. Let out a wave of noise so that they could locate where it was. Right, so those images were released in 1995, and I actually did some projects with those images of Africa. And then in 1999, ICONOS was finally launched, which was a 1 meter resolution satellite, and that was the first time that the New York Times used a satellite as an investigative journalist. When the war in Grozny was going on, and it was not safe for any journalist to go there, right? So just to reiterate, right? This is a little history that really has not been written about very much, but it's very unique and very defined satellites, each with a program, a political program associated with it, which were very specific to moments in U.S. history. All the satellites that I've been using were U.S. satellites, and these are the familiar looking Iraqi images. And when Colin Powell presented his reasons for the war in Iraq, he said, let me say, and it was all, if you remember, it was all based on weapons of mass destruction, which was supposedly seen in these satellite images with all kinds of, labels and things that were made by the image interpreters. And he said, let me say a word about satellite images before I show you a couple. The photos I'm about to show you are sometimes hard for the average person to interpret, hard for me. The painstaking work of photo analysis takes experts with years and years of experience poring for hours and hours over light tables. But as I show you these images, I'll try to capture and explain what they mean, what they indicate to our imagery specialists, right? So this is really something that when you talk to image interpreters, they'll tell you over and over again that image interpretation is both an art and a science. You have to know what you're looking for to interpret. It's, in the end, it's right, people who work with satellite imagery know that it's just, in the end, it's just an image, but it's also coordinated with geographic coordinates. And there's other ways that you can get below the architecture of the specific pixel. So these were some pamphlets that were dropped by the US military into Iraq, claiming that they can see everything from satellites. But in the end, the world has actually really changed because of this whole idea of this so-called global transparency that anybody with a credit card can purchase an image. But there is still this right for the US government to invoke what they call shutter control, which is actually written into all the legal documentation of what's allowed and not allowed to happen with high-resolution satellite imagery. But they've never actually invoked shutter control because it would be so, it would just be so remarkable. But instead, in 2001, and this was the installation at ZKM of the destruction of the World Trade Centers, but at the same time, the US government had purchased the right to all imagery over Afghanistan for a period of 2 months. And in fact, when you called up the satellite companies and asked them to sell you imagery over Iraq, they would say they self-censored to say that they wouldn't sell you an image if it had a tank or any U.S. Troop, any evidence of the United States troops in the imagery. So that's how the book goes. It sort of tries to record some of this history. But I also have the unique small claim to fame of having done the first GPS art project. This was in 1995 at the MACBA in Barcelona. And this was before the US military had taken away what they called the scatter that a civilian GPS receiver, everybody knows what a GPS receiver is. At the time when I did this project, I still had to explain what GPS was. I had to explain all the 24 satellites and all the things that I don't have to do now. But the military did really scramble the signal. And so what I had to do was correct the scattering of the signal by a receiver, in a remote location to reduce that scatter. And then you would average a location, which is actually still what's done with most GPS type projects. And then I also, sort of wrote the letters of the word museo on the top of the Richard Meyer grid, which was very easy to do because its buildings are so gridded. But that was, the idea behind the project was really not just to draw a map of the museum, but to really try and understand the architecture of the mapping system and the fact that you could actually exist as a person in two different locations at the same time. So while I was doing this project, there was still, everybody was much more interested in the World Wide Web than in GPS, and now we actually can't imagine our phones without GPS in them because they direct us to so many different places in the city. So it's been a real transformation, in the web world from things that happen inside the so-called cyberspace of the machine to much more of a you could even say that web space right now is more of a priority space for many people than physical space, depending, you know, which part of the world you live in or which worlds you live in. But there are many places, there are many situations where a digital space takes priority over a physical space, and I was trying to prove that over and over and over again with the satellite technologies and imagery. So another time that this happened was, again, before the 1 meter resolution satellite imagery, and this was an image that was published by the US military, but was part of the NATO war in Kosovo. It became an image of the Time magazine image of the century in terms of technological images. And what it is it's a mass grave in Kosovo, and then the digging up of a mass grave in Kosovo. But the way that it was released by the military, and you know, now this kind of imagery was declassified, but still, as it was released, it was only released as an image, not with any data associated with it. So you could, you know, that they said there was a mass grave and there was a mass grave upturned. They didn't give you any record of the longitude and latitude of the grave. They didn't allow you to open up the image in your own satellite program. You could only open it up in Photoshop as a really reduced TIFF, right? It wasn't, you didn't get the raw pixels that composed the image that would allow you to check, right, on this data. So it wasn't as if I was trying to prove that the military was right. I actually did believe that there was a mass grave and there was a mass grave upturned. I did believe that, you know, by looking, listening to the news and digging up other sources and seeing video and, you know, all kinds of ways that you could check, right, with multiple dimensions. But all I could do was purchase lower resolution satellite imagery. So this is a color one of that very day that supposedly the mass grave was there and that it had been dug up, right? It had to be that specific day. And the reason I knew that there was imagery on that specific day was that satellites can only take images with no clouds. So although there was so-called so much satellite surveillance going on during the war, there were only about 3 or 4 days in which you could actually get images, whether you were any military, right, unless you were using drones. So I found a drone image, which was a German image, which showed the location of the graves by a road. And then I looked at the spot image, which was much lower resolution, but I came to believe that this was the road. Right, and again, right, it wasn't that I was trying to prove that this was true or false. It was more that I was trying to reinstate the data back into the image so that you could claim it's, I don't know, I'm not quite sure what the right word to use over here is, but what I did was I called it a digital memorial because the earth, the rain, you know, washes away the evidence of the upturned grave, the grass grows again, and this is really all that remained. But then when I put it into Photoshop, again, I, you know, the image, the shape of the image really did recall the mass grave. So then when I actually did get to purchase satellite imagery, I had a budget to purchase 4 scenes. And I decided that I was going to try and look for single color places on the face of the earth. I didn't quite know what would happen at the time or why I was doing this. It was for an installation at the Whitney, and there was this Ellsworth Kelly very formal painting. But it turned out that it's actually very hard to find single color images that are, you know, delimited by the spatial frame of the satellite, which is 8 kilometers by 8 kilometers in this case. So green is the rainforest in Cameroon, where I was searching with an NGO for an illegal road in the forest. Blue happens to be the 0-0 point on Earth, and that was kind of an abstract point at which everything got measured, but because everything gets measured and calibrated to that point, there's a lot of photos in the archive. I didn't actually have to direct the satellite to go there. I could just choose from a bunch of different images. White is Anwar, Alaska, where at the time of the Iraq, the second, the 2002 Iraq war, Iraq-Kuwait war, the US was trying to drill for oil in Anwar, Alaska, which is a natural reserve. So I was, you know, looking for an image of snow, and they really made me pay full price for that image, and couldn't talk to me about why, you know, it was such a degraded image in their satellite database. We had very funny conversations about that. So the cropped images were displayed in the gallery like that, and then when I actually zoomed in on the image, there did happen to be two helicopters there, which the satellite company didn't know at the time, otherwise they wouldn't have sold it to me, because at the time I was looking for a different image. Yeah, so the images are really beautiful. And then the NGO that I was working with in Cameroon, this is the way they used the imagery, because they have this, you know, on the ground, in the sky approach to their NGO. And that was the Landsat image that they have, where the road didn't really show up. And they actually don't use high resolution imagery because they don't have enough money, and also because it's kind of ridiculous to use high resolution imagery for trees. you don't really need it. So, and NGOs nowadays are drawing the roads of the world with Landsat imagery, because you can actually see quite a lot. But in this case, this is the way they used the image in a court of law to help, you know, define one of the illegal forest zones. Then I did some more work in Brazil and Indonesia. In this case, it was soybeans and palm oil, which are replacing the forest. Okay, so that moves me now really from the book into the world of data visualization, first GIS and then data visualization. And I want to just take a little break here and tell you a little bit about how I think about this whole world of data that's taking over, you know, big data, taking over with such a storm in a lot of universities, in a lot of newspapers, data journalism, data everything that's going on right now. So, and I like to call it para-empiricism, because data is usually thought of as this concrete facts of the world. You know, you can measure everything. Everything has quantitative, material, objective definitions in the world of data. But data in my projects are representations. They're delegates or emissaries of reality. But not only that the presentations of things themselves, figures, mediation, subject to the rhetoric of aesthetic and all images and narratives. So, you know, I no matter what you're talking about, there's no such thing as raw data, and there's no such thing as neutral data. Data is always collected for a very specific purpose by a combination of people, technology, money, commerce, and government. Data defines multiple and new dimensions of space, and as architects, we must try to understand the often unintended consequences of inhabiting the unruly and dominant spaces that data opens up. So this word para-empirical has become really important for me as I really try and take apart the different data sets that I work with. So the first project that I really worked with in this way, and I'm just going to show a tiny bit of this project, is the Million Dollar Blocks project, where we took a data set like this, which is data released by the courts as people are given prison sentences. But instead of looking at what normally gets looked at, the crime that somebody commits, we looked at the home address of an incarcerated person, right? So the US has the highest incarceration rates in the world. And so when we looked at the data in geographic context, we found, you know, each dot over there is a person, what a person says their home address is in prison. And then you correlate that to the smallest political entity that comes out of the US Census, which is the called the census block. And so the data in that context shows that people are highly concentrated in specific neighborhoods. So each bright red dot is a census block that has a high level of incarceration. So when you added that up block by block, it cost $359 million to imprison people from Brooklyn that year. And again, the bright red dots are the highest rates of incarceration. And what we did was we added the price of incarceration to each of those census, to each person. So it costs about $30,000 to $40,000 to have someone incarcerated in for the length of a year. So from a demographic point of view, the spending facilitates a mass migration of people to prison. 95% of return home. So these are lines that connect the home address of a person in Brooklyn to where they are incarcerated, usually upstate New York, where poor white post-industrial cities are now profiting from these prisons being located in those small towns. So when you look at it from an urban point of view, we focused on a specific community district, another political border, which has 3.5% of Brooklyn's population, but 8.5% of its prison emissions. And this was a pattern all around the United States. So when you look at that, those particular census blocks, these are the people who live there. This is the cost to incarcerate them over the length of their sentence that year. These are the buildings they live in. And so those 11 blocks, it cost $11 million, and so we came to call the project million-dollar blocks. So on a financial scale, prison is becoming the predominant governing institution in the neighborhood, but the money goes elsewhere. So this became a five-year-long project. We did all kinds of community-oriented documentation. We did all kinds of workshops. If you look on our website, you'll see how this project really played out. So in that sense, this project moved us to a whole lot of other data-oriented project. And so I want to just come quickly to the title of my talk, which is Multiple Dimensions, and you could link it closely to parametrics in this sense, a very different kind of parametrics than the noodly-shaped ones that come out of most of the architecture world. But the English prefix para comes from the Greek word meaning by the side of, beside, hence alongside, past and beyond. It has come to denote such words as parametric, paramilitary, sense of auxiliary, almost not quite functional, but not really a substitute. It's this double sense of alongsidedness and incompleteness that I employ this neologism. Metrics, because they involve data, as I've defined before, are both quantitative and qualitative, political and technologically, never neutral. I'm often told that my work is flat, but in fact, it is always in multiple dimensions, in the way that a scientist uses these terms. Even though represented physically in 2D or sometimes even 4D, including time, there are many other variables which define any point on an XY axis of any image that I'll present over and over today. So this is another project that's going on in the lab now, which is called 1 Million Books, because we have been visualizing the Columbia Library catalog. Okay, so the library catalog, as you know, has been, well, you don't know this, but the Columbia Library has 8.5 million records and 7.5 million books. And only 1 million are circulated, even though it's a misleading number, but a lot of books are kept off-site, right? And in a lot of libraries, it happens this way. So, and there's about 150 books circulating at one time. So what we didn't want to do was this, which is a way that most library visualizations and most sort of virtual library projects are played out. That they try and replicate the library catalog by browsing, the shelves from a remote site. And this is what they're doing at Harvard, right? So you can actually go and browse the books on a particular shelf. They've mapped the library down to the specific shelf, right? And it seems to me that that's a really stupid way of, not that it's not useful if you want to only browse the books in the library, but if you're going to virtualize the catalog, I think the most important thing to try and do is to try and think, what other spaces can you open up? What other kinds of searches could you have happen, other than what we know, which is the Amazon. You know, we all love the thing. You know, you buy your book is very similar to, I'm sure, John's book. it often happens at mine and Eyal's book. That kind of, it's, you know, a lot of similar things come up because it's the algorithm that defines what's similar and what other people like. So what other ways are there that you can search the library and actually create new categories that would come out of this virtual categorization? So the first thing we did was actually to visualize the catalog, and these are the, you know, the Library of Congress catalogs, which most university libraries use. So these are the books summed by holdings per subject. And then this is book circulation activity per subject, which means the most popular book circulating at Columbia right now is the statistics textbook. And that's the kind of thing that comes up. Also, the fetal reproduction was another one that came up. So what we've been trying to do, and we're trying to do this in a lot of different ways, and this is actually, I'm showing you really a project in progress right now, is we've taken the million books that are within the library catalog and looking at the top level and saying which are defined in interdisciplinary categories. So what is architecture, art, music, or math, you know, art and music. So that's what we've done, and we actually created a tool where you can now browse for books that are interdisciplinary, and you can see how many categories there are, and then you can actually click on the book and go to it in the catalog, and then you can browse. So you're browsing by what are the most interdisciplinary books, not where are books on the shelf, right? So we're actually creating tools for the library, which really challenge the virtual organization of its catalog, and they're very happy with this. And then another thing that we're doing right now, and to do this, we actually are using a database of pirate libraries. It's not a right word for it, but that's what everybody likes to call it. So you know what they are, right? They're somewhat gray legality books that are scanned. And what we're doing, it's called the Syllabus Project, and we're taking the syllabus of a professor, the citations in the papers, and then the structural organization is just the Library of Congress categories. And then we're trying to make links between the books that are in all these different kind of subject headings. And to do that, we're gonna search these digital copies of books that are circulating, and we've downloaded, like, I don't know, something like 10 million books. But a lot of Columbia students actually go to those libraries rather than the physical library to check out books. Okay, so another project that we're doing right now is called, we're calling it, it's a provisional name, it's actually a really bad name. But as you know, there's no Twitter or Facebook in China. There are ways that you can get the outside internet, but as you know, the Chinese have created their own internet, which is very governed and controlled. And there's two sides of this kind of space, because on the one hand, yes, it's governed and controlled. On the other hand, people have really found a lot of ways of being activists within the space that's actually not possible in physical space, or more dangerous in physical space. And some of the tactics that they've used are extremely funny and actually not so dangerous as everybody thinks that they are. So what we did was we accessed the Weibo, the Chinese Weibo, Microbox, Sino Weibo, and we followed 100 users that have more than 100 followers, and they were journalists and lawyers. And because the Weibo actually has an open API like Twitter, so it's weird, right? The Chinese are highly monitoring and controlling this. On the other hand, it has an open API, which means that you can scrape everything that's been posted. And so what we did was we collected about 2 months worth of the posts of these people. And what you find is that instead of posting text, They post. They take photographs. If something has been deleted, they actually they start to be able to see these patterns, and they download posts that they think are going to be dangerous really fast, and then they repost it, but as an image, not as a text, right? So the censors have a harder time recognizing those posts because it's not so fast. They can't do it machine operated. They have to do it with human eyes, right? And so what happens is this is a long form Weibo post, and they're reposted, and then they spread like wildfire. And that way, you know, you can't stop anyone because the right, the organization of it is really dispersed. So that's what we did, and so the arrows, this is our visualization of it, which has not been published because I don't have enough time to go into it, but if somebody wants to come and ask me afterwards, I can explain. But it's the arrow is a specific user, and it shows the number of times the post has been reposted, and at the long side of the rectangle, of the triangle, is when it got deleted. So we eventually actually collaborated with ProPublica, which is an investigative journalism website, one of the few real investigative journalist sites left. And we had pizza dinners, and we got a lot of people to look at these posts because I don't read Chinese, we couldn't actually translate them, and came up with all these categories which the imagery was organized around. So there's political speech, there's the long text that I just show you, there's images of dissidents. There were two particular dissidents that were very popular, in terms of posting and reposting about those particular months. Protests, then there's also some cartoons and really, really funny things as well. And then what we did was we published it. We made sure to take away the name of the person. We actually also published it anonymously. None of the names of the journalists were public in case any of the people had relatives in China. And we translated a lot of these things. So if you, there were actually some really, really funny things. But if you go to this link, it's how to get censored on China's Twitter, and it's just ProPublica.org, and you'll find it, and you can really read the translation of all these images. It's really a fascinating thing. Okay, and so I'm going to end with a project which is another very large-scale collaboration. It was an exhibit at the Cartier Foundation in Paris, where Diller and Scofidio were invited to collaborate with Paul Virilio on this project, which was about mapping human migration worldwide. And at the bottom of this was really a mandate about climate change, because the fact that, you know, over 50% of the world is now living in cities. In 2007, when this show was up, that was the what was called the tipping point, right, where more than half the world were now living in cities. So what you call the charismatic icon of this change, and it's just like we hear over and over and over again ad nauseum, was this hockey stick of the Al Gore movie, you know, that population is going way up, or the polar bear. And we decided that's really not what we wanted to do. It's going to bring me back again to the blue marble. And also to the fact that nowadays, you know, things are not really only surveilled by overhead views and by satellite imagery, and probably the fact that it's so easy to purchase a satellite image is that the real surveillance has shifted elsewhere to telephone calls and network structures and things like this. And so what we did was we decided to curate a data set which would really explain the world in motion. But to do that, we wanted to use only data about people. And the show traveled quite a bit. So what we did was we curated the data set and organized it into these six scenes. So
population shift, cities, remittances, political refugees, and forced migration, natural disasters, rising seas and sinking cities. The show was, the blue marble was, actually the new generation blue marble was sort of rolling around the room and printing out these data sets. There were six projectors when everything was spliced together, and so it was these very long rolls of film, really. That's what we were producing. We were producing these long things, and then they got stitched together and turned into a panoramic thing. So that image that you just saw, there are the 6 billion people on Earth. Each of these pixels represents 1,000 people. And 2007, as I said, marked a threshold. More than half of the world's population was living in a city. So soon you can see the marble. And what we did was we used a database produced at Columbia called the Globe. It's called the GRUMP database. If you look it up, it's produced by season. And what it does is it counts the census on 1 square kilometer of every point on Earth. Now, there's a lot of mistakes in that database because you're relying on the census count of all kinds of corrupt governments. Nevertheless, it's at least a count, and it and we acknowledge the errors, and it also predicts population. That's whenever you hear there's going to be, you know, in 2012, there's going to be 75% of the world living in cities, all of those things that were in Ricky Burdett's book. I guess you must all know who Ricky Burdett is over here. That's where those statistics come from, is that particular data set. So this is how it worked. So that was the blue marble going around the world, going around the room. And then the next part of this was that we drew these lines across the map, and which is really a section cut through the population, you know, the population count. And these are the 50 fastest growing cities. This is how, what happened was, the first revolution of the globe was about shrinking cities. Lines drop down in population count. And then as it comes around again, you see the cities that are growing. So, and then it moves to the fastest growing cities. And then it turned into sort of a rail station ticker where the gridded population of the world was sort of counting up and shrinking, like that. So we have video of that too. Okay, so I'm not really doing these scenes in order, but the one later in the 45-minute show, so this is so-called environmental refugees, which is not a legal term. Political refugees are a legal term. So according to a lot of different databases, natural disasters have increased 8.4% over the last 8 years, tripling the number of people affected. So a lot of these databases came from insurance agencies and from death counts, actually nothing to do with people moving around the world. So we took those databases and overlaid them onto our season database. And so this was showing floods, droughts and earthquakes overlaid onto you know, where the largest population was, because you know, there's no particular disaster unless there's a lot of people who, in our show, there was no particular disaster unless a lot of people had to be moved. And to do this, we kept on noticing the line between the global north and the global south, and the fact that the people who are most responsible for climate change are the least affected by it, and vice versa. So the scene that really demonstrated this and illustrated it the most clearly was the flood database, which came out of Dartmouth University in the US, tiny little university, and they were the only ones that actually recorded when there was a flood, how many people were displaced from their homes. And estimated, you know, but nevertheless, they didn't only count, you know, the damaged buildings and the people dead. So, right, so 61 million people were displaced by floods between January 2006. It was a one and a half year database. But what was really interesting to see was that floods of the same magnitude, significantly more people are displaced in the global south than the global north, and this was an absolute pattern in the data. That's how we showed it. So this is the line. We had an amazing team over here. We had a statistician. We had really great data visualization people as well. But we were really, you know, designing this on the fly with processing and OpenGL and really splicing. It's very manually made, so we couldn't really update this very quickly, which is not a great thing. But but it was very effective. And okay, so then this was the part about rising seas, and we were trying to show where the carbon dioxide levels in the atmosphere increase, and that a small increase in global temperature causes the oceans to warm, the polar ice caps to melt, and sea levels to rise. Right, so it's not just about the polar caps. And we, you know, we did this animation, predictive animation. The blue marble picked up all kinds of carbon. And then we, you know, through data analysis, we discovered that there's 9,000 cities that are within 100 kilometers of the ocean. And the statistic that with 1 centimeter of rise in sea level puts 1 million people at risk of displacement. And we were really, you know, we weren't doing the Al Gore version of this, which is really extreme. It was, you know, really only talking about 1 meter rise in sea level. So that's the carbon produced by companies and countries in the global north. And here it becomes less distinct, of course, between the global north and the global south. And it became a real research project for us to differentiate which cities were more vulnerable than one another. And no matter who we called to ask, nobody would give us any kind of indice, or nobody would come up with a statistical way of calculating this kind of thing. And so we really decided rather to pose it as a question. The difference, but you know, New York is one of the 10 most vulnerable cities in the world to sea level rise, because of where its infrastructure is placed. And a city like Mumbai is also one of the 10, the 10 most vulnerable cities. So what we did was we kind of showed all the cities in the world, all those 9,000 cities sinking, and then we showed them being, you know, taken over by water. And then kind of ask questions, you know, which cities are more vulnerable than one another. And there are kinds of ways of asking the question, you know, political stability, you know, GDP. I mean, there's all these indicators which governments ask about, but nobody can come up with an exact formula, right? There's all the algorithms in the world for how to find a book that's similar to the next one, but not for which cities are more vulnerable to climate change. And I think, you know, I think it's important to stop and ask yourself why. Okay. Okay, so another project that we're working on, I thought this was the last project, but it's not. I have two more short projects to show, is about shipping. And this one happens to be about oil tankers around that are, and you know, it's a funny thing, but ships are not, you know, air flights are mapped incessantly and consistently, but it's really hard to map ships and to map shipping as a global phenomenon. Whereas, you know, financial data moves around the world very quickly, people and things move at a much slower pace. So we were given access to an incredible trove of shipping data, and so this is. And this is only ships carrying crude oil and gas. And so they're the only ships that are actually uniformly carrying one thing. A lot of other shipping happens where containers are amassed together and you actually don't know what's being shipped until the port of entry. You don't have to record it at the point of exit, but only at the point of entry. So we started off this project just there's about 5,000 ships which deliver oil around the globe. And we had a data set of ships traveling to the United States. So first, this was just, you know, the records of 10 million ship locations from 2011, and it showed all kinds of very odd shipping patterns, and, you know, including the fact that it just draws the map of the world without even having the political boundaries. There's no lines there which separate the countries, so it was really, that's an amazing thing. And there's about 50,000 connection points. Just to bring up the Mercator map of the world, because it was optimized for navigational routes, and so we decided to use the Mercator map as our underlay for the maps. And so what we're doing now is we're making an interactive an interactive site to explore these shipping routes. And we're trying to, and it's actually a common theme amongst a lot of the projects in the lab, where we're bringing together big data and ethnography and trying to visualize things at multiple scales so that you can tell stories at the same time as have the global map in the background and start asking questions about patterns. And so this is now native to HTML5, where you can collate a lot of different images and links and movies and all together in a very easy to use interface. And another project that we're working on right now also has to do with remittances. In fact, this was part of the Terra Natal story as well, that this is people moving around the world voluntarily. It has nothing to do, so to speak, with climate change, except it's one of the reasons that urban areas are getting people are moving from rural areas to cities. And they send money home in informal ways at the amount of $200 per year. So when you compare that to foreign aid, this kind of informal number outnumbers foreign aid about 3-1. So this is how we did it in Terra Natal. You know, there's around 251 countries in the world. The United States had the most people moving there in 2007 and sent the most amount of money to Mexico, then India, Philippines, et cetera. So think the UK showed up in the top 12, but it didn't show up in the top 5 countries. So really what this is showing is a transnationalism and people who are living in two places at one time. And what we're starting to do now is collecting stories about this kind of thing and trying to ask what is the money being used for in the country of origin. So this is a community in actually what used to be called Little Korea in Los Angeles. A sort of south central LA, and a lot of people from Oaxaca are living in this 5-block area of Los Angeles, and they're sending money. They actually have to pay tax to go back and live in their country, in their village of origin for the summer. And this is a festival that they're having in LA. And we're starting to collect all kinds of local stories from New York this way and making the transnational links. And I think, yeah, that's where I'll end with this global, local thing and a lot of people who worked with me on these projects. And I'd love to take questions. So.
Yeah. Thank you, Laura. Yeah. Do we have questions from the floor?
Hello.
Hi.
I'd like to know who are the major clients buying your images. Is it mostly some consultancy agency or maybe some art galleries? Like, who are the people that are more interested by the images you're producing?
Well, that's actually an interesting question because I would say that the work in my book, up until Million Dollar Blocks, was mostly funded by museums. And I was doing my research, you know, but most of it was funded by exhibits all around the world, whichever place I was doing it. Now, I don't really have clients. I really look for projects that I'm interested in. It's usually to do with mapping, as you can see, usually, or to do with some kind of spatial redefinition, but mostly funded by grants, sometimes by corporations. So Open Society Institute has funded my work, as has Thomson Reuters, which is the shipping project, and the library project and the Weibo project. That's all. Yeah, so we just get grants all the time, the Rockefeller Foundation, things like that.
Thank you. Yeah. So I was thinking about the project about the visualization of floods, the floods database. And I was in my head while you were speaking comparing it to the incarceration project.
Yeah.
I was thinking whether you have ever thought of, for instance, expanding that flood database to include other kinds of data, such as the cost of, repairing the damages wrecked by floods.
Mm-hmm.
Because it seems to me that when I compare it with the incarceration project, it seems to miss, in a certain sense, the kind of political dimension that the incarceration data acquires when you start talking about how the money moves from one place to the other, right? But I don't have the complete picture of that project.
Yeah. Well, the incarceration project was, I could have shown much more of that project, but it was really a policy-oriented project, and we were working with people who were at policy, working to reduce prison budgets and, things like that. The Terre Natale was in a museum. It was collaboration with Paul Virilio, and it was about specifically people moving around the world, right? So if I were to take on flooding in another context, I would do something different with the data. I might, you know, zoom in on the, you know, on exactly where the flood was in Mumbai, find that it was in a, you know, probably where millions of people are actually living on a floodplain, right, with no water and things like that. So there's you could definitely zoom in to tell a more local story, which is why I'm working on this interface where you can bring together the local and the global together. So I would like every project that I do to be like Million Dollar Blocks, but it's very, very detailed data. And that's not as so easy to get, right? And that's why, because of the nature of the collaboration, we had access to really to incredible data sources, and to be able, and also to be allowed to use the data at that fine grain of detail, which you're often not allowed to use. You often get data with all kinds of limits. You're only allowed to show it at a zip code level. You're only allowed to do it at this level, that, right? So I think as more data becomes available, there's infinite amounts of things that you can do, but I don't think you can solve the world's problems with data. You have to ask the specific questions in specific projects, you know, with specific intent. Yeah, does that? Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Thank you, Laura, and I have somewhat of a follow-up question, because I was wondering whether post-Colin Powell's sort of annotation of the satellite imagery, whether, first of all, whether that always introduces the potential skepticism. So I was curious, I guess, in terms of thinking about data visualization, to what extent it both reveals but also potentially kind of covers mm-hmm. over.
Yeah.
And I asked that a little bit in relationship to some of the final images, because it seems very similar to the various data sets I've seen that have tried to visualize the drone war, and in some way statistics are in fact the dominant way that we understand that aspect of the war on terror. Numbers of people, numbers of strikes, numbers yeah. of people injured or killed, the image of the understanding of what's happening on the ground in some way is what's in fact missing. And so there is this kind of tension between the sort of imminent on the ground kind of lived experience of people versus a kind of a certain level of abstraction produced by statistics, et cetera.
Yeah.
So I'd like to ask you about that kind of tension.
Yeah. Well, there are ways in which, you know, I would obviously resist that, you know, that tension, because I think that you have to unpack the data in the same way as you have to unpack the on the ground, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's equal ways in which you have to mistrust both. So I know there are people who take the Jacob Riis approach, that you have to go there with your camera, et cetera. But it's not to say that the one should be used and not the other. Obviously, they should be interchangeable. The Terre Natale, I think that one is the one that's the most guilty of that. But there was a photography show on the upper level, which was all about disappearing languages and people in the forests, and you know, so that's the show was a dialogue between those two.
Mm-hmm.
I thought it was, I should have shown it, but I actually had problems with it, because that was only about one data set, and they wanted us to zoom constantly on all these other stories. It would have been impossible to do, number one, in the frame of 5 months, but also, you know, we were very clear that this is about a global map, and this is what you can see from a global map. So the main story that we were trying to tell was the disparity between the global north and the global south, who was producing the most carbon, who was getting the most displaced people. So yes, it didn't have on the ground, but it couldn't have. So I think, you know, if you're suspicious of your data sources and you're communicating with them responsibly, I think what's more important is that people need to learn how to read statistics in as critical a way that they know how to read images, you know? And there's not, with the prevalence, the so-called prevalence of data, there's not enough knowledge. And that's what I try and, I mean, that's what I, that's the gap I try to fill. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, Laura. I have a question for either your research as in a research idea or maybe other people's research, and it concerns urban planning mm-hmm. and food consumption. And this is probably, if you think about it, is urban planning in related to healthcare. So is there anybody researching how you plan an area and whether or not the people who are obese or what kind mm-hmm. of food they eat and all that,
yeah.
Is there sort of an angle there where you can start to see some correlation or relationship mm-hmm. between all these different things that says, you know, the way that it's planned, the way the food court is, therefore you get these issues,
right.
whether
yeah,
it is health or political.
There's tons of people doing that, but they're in public health, not in architecture.
Yeah.
And that's another gap that I'm trying to, because I often feel like I take architecture to other disciplines or take spatial analysis to other disciplines. Mm-hmm. So you find tons of people doing that in public health, and I know a lot of them, you know, so they find, you know, fast food, and they do all these studies about that, and walkability, it sounds very new urbanist, but there's lots of people studying that kind of thing. But then to communicate that to a broader public, you find a huge gap, you know, in the sort of a very sterile, ugly GIS data, which then, you know, is also very aggregated at a higher level. But there's lots of people doing crowdsourcing with that kind of thing, and fresh food. In New York, it's a huge thing. I don't know what it's like here in the UK, where the people are doing that, but there's a lot of projects that I can tell you about. I can send you some links, yeah.
I have a
yeah.
question.
Yeah.
First of all, thank you very much for the beautiful talk. My question has to do with the declassification of the images that you talked at the beginning. The enormous amount of efforts put by the military in training
mm-hmm.
young
yeah.
marshals in reading those images,
yeah.
or during the early period, actually young girls training the people who would eventually read them, somehow indicates also a shift in what we call today division of labor.
Mm-hmm.
It was one of the first efforts of what we can call immaterial labor. And
mm-hmm.
it was an amazing organization of immaterial labor in order to achieve a specific goal. But the model through which it operated was clearly aimed at something.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it seems that many of the data sets that you are tapping into are aimed at different goals.
Yeah.
Somehow you are trying to misuse them or to read through
mm-hmm.
them.
Yeah.
So my question is about, on one side, the visual interpretation and whether you could recognize in your work a way through which architecture can achieve a different agency by
yeah.
training people to see spatial relation. And on the other side, the question would be about modeling.
Yeah.
What models are these images for? And what kind of modeling and model thinking is behind the work that you are intercepting?
So the declassification question is the misuse of, yeah. So I would say there's an equal amount of the intentional repurposing of data sets. That's one of the things that I do. That was the most creative part of the Million Dollar Blocks project, was using this municipal data set, you know, for completely other reason. And most of the time you see people just visualizing the data, right? Whereas it's actually usually putting two data sets together that tells a story. And I really do see as my mission moving forward is this whole idea of literacy, right? Of a spatial data literacy, which I think we all, you know, with so much data about cities and, you know, whatever being opened up, we need to have more training in that. Like I keep saying at Columbia, we need to teach GIS as a statistical program. You know, we really actually need to start being able to be discerning what's a, you know, like you, if you read an article in the newspaper, you go, on the one hand, you see this and you might think this, and on the other hand, you know, you might see that. You never see that with statistics. Right, and that's the kind of storytelling I think needs to start happening, which we do try and do. But I do, I think we need new programs. You know, I do think all of this work is something that can be done, and especially because so much of it is open sourced right now as well. Yeah.
Hello. So I have a question that is maybe very broad, but I was wondering if you could speak of the relation between understanding and action, and maybe to take a specific case, the understanding of a specific context in million-dollar blocks,
mm-hmm.
and how and in architectural proposal, in the sense of. You know, building the forms that structure space.
Yeah, the architecture part is hard to answer because I don't know. I think of architecture as much broader than simply building. And that's the way that I would ask that question. So a lot of the projects that I take on are sort of pre-architectural in the limited use of the word architecture. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, it opens up the action part and how data can become knowledge. I think of it as a new kind of navigation towards parts of the city that you know, and I don't mean like going to the poor parts of city, you know, but I mean that it opens up these multi-dimensional spaces, right? That you have to say there's not just an X and a Y axis, there's an X and a Y and a Z, and then there's like 100 extra categories which you have to take into account when you think about, right, moving into a place and trying to change something. And then it becomes a very messy, right, a messy space that you're interacting with. And I think those are the kinds of questions we need to ask as architects, but I really am still forming. Yeah, although these are very good questions, yeah.
Hi, Laura. Yeah. thanks so much, that was really great. Can you hear me at the front?
Yes,
yeah. I was interested in what I see as quite a shift in your work, mm-hmm. from the sort of map as political agent in the early work to the more narrative kind of visualizations, the map is the telling of stories in the later work.
Yeah.
And just, I mean, do you find a visual tension between those two modes?
Well, I often try and, experiment with these new interfaces and things like that. And I do, you saw my book took a long time to publish. Like, books are not they're not my first way of communicating, right? And so, I think you're right. There's definitely a shift between the map as a static thing and, right, and then being able to enter these spaces. And I think narrative is always a part of architecture, and you're always trying to tell make arguments and tell stories. And so the storytelling part might be more the argument made visible within the interface rather than writing and a map, right? And I think, but that's because of HTML5, and I see that as a huge new potential which all of us can exploit that space as a new kind of communication. So I don't see it as a tension as much as a development of modes of communication. And I don't know if you guys all know about D3, but that's a lot of the later projects were done in D3, which is interactive mapping. And then you can click on something and it's all native to HTML5, so you can bring in a movie and that kind of thing. I think it's brand new. It's really brand new. So it's not very processed right now. I'm showing a lot of work in progress here. Yeah. So that's where the tension might, you know, might be. It's not finished work as much as the first parts are, and you can. It's much easier to tell your argument when the project is finished.
Yeah. So, I think that was the last question. So. Maybe we can all join in thanking Laura for her great talk this evening. Thank you very much, Laura. Before you all go, try to have a look at her wonderful new book. Just came out from Zone Book. Close up at the distance.